So yesterday we looked at Petrarch and how he kind of created the ideas that became known as humanism in his monumental work, The Ascent of Mount Ventoux. And today we're going to you're going to take some time to look at how those ideas express themselves in the visual arts. But I want to first start with some background and some history. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to move ourselves all the way back to the 12th century. Here, the church stands like a mighty fortress, fighting darkness with its imposing buildings. Picture a fortress, but not for soldiers, but for prayer. The churches then had thick walls and towers with few decorations. They stood tall, showing off the church's strength, especially in areas where people had only recently let go of their old beliefs for Christianity. These weren't just buildings, they were statements of power by the church against evil, waiting for the final victory on Judgment Day. The statues and carvings you find in these churches aren't meant to be pretty or delicate like ancient Greek sculptures. They're grand, solid, and simple, making it easier to understand what they were meant to represent. These weren't just fancy artworks. They were a special code of sacred symbols that told the story. Romanesque artists had a way of creating that was less about copying real life and more about expressing spiritual ideas, which also let them play around with new complex designs. Now, moving to the 13th century, things start to change significantly. Imagine going from a dark, solid, Romanesque church into a Gothic cathedral. It would have been like walking into a bit of heaven on earth. Instead of the tough, grim buildings before, Gothic cathedrals were full of light and stained glass, shining like jewels, and old gold decorations sparkling everywhere. This style was meant to lift people's spirits and make them feel closer to the divine mysteries beyond our world. And Gothic art starts to bring statues to life, making them real and part of a lively story rather than just sticking them onto buildings as decoration. Now the figures were unique, with their own attitudes and type of beauty. And while they're still symbolic, they also started to look more like real people. The artists were trying harder to tell religious stories through their art. They cared more about the message and the comfort it would bring people, rather than just showing off their skills. Now, by the time we reach Giotto and in the Renaissance, Italy was starting to remember its glorious past and wanting to look back to the greatness of ancient Rome. Gothic had become a negative term, referring to what they considered the barbaric time that had destroyed their ancient glory. Enter Giotto, an artist whose paintings changed everything. He used techniques to make images look three-dimensional, with depth and realism that hadn't been seen in centuries. His art wasn't just a repeat of old stories, it was like watching the sacred tales unfold right in front of you, which was a whole way, new way of experiencing paintings. As we hit the Renaissance proper in the 15th century, artists like Leonardo da Vinci took painting to a new level. They made figures in their art so lifelike that they seemed to be breathing, with soft edges and colors that made the images seem real. Look here at Da Vinci's Mona Lisa, and you'll notice how the mystery of her smile is made with shades and subtle details that lead you guessing her mood. Michelangelo's work, especially in the Sistine Chapel, is another marvel. Painting the chapel ceiling was a huge task, both physically and artistically. When you look up at it, it's like entering another world full of prophets and sibyls that look like they could speak to you. Michelangelo's figures are enormous, full of thought and emotion, showing his unmatched ability to create in the divine narrative of paint. The change from the older Romanesque to the newer Renaissance style was a big deal in art history because people started to recognize and celebrate individual artists for their work. Before this, artists were often anonymous, just like any other skilled workers, such as tailors or cabinet makers. Giotto was one of the first artists who got famous for his art, and after him, the trend continued in Italy and elsewhere. Giorgio Vasari's book, The Lives of the Most Excellent Painters, Sculptors, and Architects, published in 1530, really hyped up this idea. He praised artists like Leonardo and Michelangelo, suggesting they were almost superhuman in their abilities, and saying that their talents were a gift to their cities. For example, he describes Michelangelo, in whose workshop Vasari was trained, as a gift from God, saying, quote, "The most benevolent ruler of heaven decided to send to earth a spirit who, working alone, was able to demonstrate in every art and every profession the meaning of perfection." The whole movement of the Renaissance put individual people, great thinkers and creators, at the heart of historical progress, not just the gods or fate. Humanism, a key part of the Renaissance, celebrated those individuals as forces who shaped nations and changed the world with their personal brilliance. The Renaissance was a time when artists were finally seen as celebrities in their own right, and their contributions were acknowledged as significant chapters in the human story. In conclusion, the evolution of the stern, symbolic, and Romanesque statues to the lifelike figures of the Renaissance marks a profound transformation in the portrayal of human form, reflecting a broader shift towards humanism and art. This movement signified an increasing value placed on the individual, with artists emerging from the shadows of anonymity to be celebrated for their unique contributions. The work of Giotto, Leonardo, and Michelangelo transcended traditional art, embodying narratives rich in human experience and emotion, and advancing personal expression. Through their canvases, these artists exemplified humanist principles that prioritize critical thinking and the human experience at the heart of society's progress. Art in this period didn't just capture the physical likeness of subjects, but also their inner lives, heralding a new era where the individual became a pivotal force in shaping cultural history. This marked the departure from medieval norms to the exaltation of the individual genius and established a foundation for Western thinking and cemented an artistic legacy that honors artists as pivotal in the chronicles of heritage and the symbols of humanity's capabilities. Thanks so much for joining me on this talk today. I hope you've learned a little bit about the history of art, and you can now be able to identify it as you look for examples in your own work.